So now that we have defined the notion of a network motif and a notion of a network subgraph, and I'm really kind of using these two terms interchangeably, now we need to, and then we also defined what is a frequency of a given motif or a frequency of a given subgraph in a given graph. Now we wanna basically develop a neural network approach that will allow us to quickly determine whether a given graph is a subgraph in a bigger graph. So to give you the next, we are going to talk about neural subgraph representations. So what's the problem? The problem is called subgraph matching. I'm given a large target graph and I'm given a small query graph. And what I have to decide whether a query is a subgraph in the target graph, right? So for example, here's my query, here's my target graph. In this case, the answer should be yes, because this particular set of four nodes can map to this particular set of four nodes and edges are preserved. Here, I use different colors to denote, you know, that this node can map to that node, you know, this node maps to this node, and so on and so forth. So query Q is included in the target graph. So that's the problem we want to do. We just want to say yes, no, right? It's not about the number yet. We just want to say, is query included? Is it a subgraph of the target graph? How are we going to do this? Rather than doing this as a kind of combinatorial matching and trying to check edge by edge if query is included in the target, we are going to develop a machine learning approach to it. So basically, we are going to formulate this as a prediction task. And our intuition will be that we are going to exploit the geometric shape of the embedding space to capture the subgraph relationship. So let me now kind of unpack what do I mean by that. So the task is that I want to do a binary prediction to return true if query is isomorphic to a subgraph of the target graph, and otherwise I return false. So again, in this case, I give you the query, the target, and the dashed edges, lines represent the node correspondences. So in this case, just note, we won't be interested in actually finding correspondences, because that's another challenging problem. And we are not going to talk about that. All we want is just true, false, right? Given query, given target, return true if query appears as a subgraph of the target, otherwise return false. We are just interested in the decision problem in the binary task. So how are we going to approach this is the following. This is kind of the high level overview of the approach. We'll take a big input graph, the target graph, and we are going to decompose it in a set of neighborhoods. And these neighborhoods will be, let's say, relatively small. So we are going to decompose it into a set of neighborhoods, and then we are going to use graph neural network to embed each neighborhood. We are going to basically apply graph embedding to create an embedding for each neighborhood. Then at the query time, we'll also take the query and we are going to embed the query. And then what we are going to do is we are going to build a predictor that will say, given the embedding of the query and embedding of a neighborhood, you know, predict yes or no, right? Yes would mean a given query is included, is a subgraph of a given neighborhood, versus that given query not being a subgraph of a given neighborhood. So for example, for this query and this neighborhood, we should predict no. For this neighborhood and the query, we predict yes. Here, we also predict yes, because it's a triangle and an edge, a triangle and an edge, and you know our query is a triangle and an edge, right? So basically, based on the embeddings, we want to make these predictions. And this can be super fast, because as I'm giving a query, I just kind of run through these neighborhoods and make predictions, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no. That's essentially the idea. So how are we going to do this? Let's give a bit more detail. We are going to work with node-anchored definitions, right? Meaning we are going to have a notion of an anchor, and we are trying to predict whether a given node-anchored query is a subgraph of, a given anchor into the target graph. So we are working with anchored definitions, where what has to do is one anchor has to map to another anchor, and then all the edges and all the other nodes have to map as well. So that's the first important point, is we have a notion of the anchor. The second important notion is that we are going to decompose the target graph into a set of neighborhoods. So, and these neighborhoods will be node anchored. And what does this mean is essentially we'll pick a node and then we'll take a k-hop neighborhood around it, but let's say one hop, two hop, and then this will create a neighborhood and we are going to embed this neighborhood. So we'll take the target graph and we are going to create many neighborhoods and embed them. And then for a given query, the task will be given the query and the neighborhood, predict whether query is a subgraph of the neighborhood. So the entire approach is the following. As I said, we create a query, pick an anchor node and embed it. We take the target graph, decompose it into many neighborhoods and embed those neighborhoods. And now, given the embedding of the query and embedding of the neighborhood, we want to predict return true or false. True if this query is a node anchored subgraph of the neighborhood, and return false if this node anchored query is not a subgraph of the node anchored neighborhood. So that's how we are going to do this. So now, of course, the question is, how do we use embeddings to make predictions, right? In terms of the creating the embedding of the neighborhood, we can use a standard graph neural network. So kind of not too much importance there. I'm kind of going to skip that detail. There are some interesting kind of architectural details, but just a standard graph neural network for embedding graphs would already be good. So now we need to decide and kind of I want to talk a bit about why do we pick anchored neighborhoods? Why not node non-anchored? Recall that the node level frequency definition says, you know, the number of nodes U in GT for which some subgraph of GT is isomorphic to the query, and the isomorphism maps node U in GT to node V in the queue, right? So basically the anchors have to map, plus all the edges and the remaining nodes can also map. The point is that we are going to create these anchored embeddings because we can then create basically a graph neural network around each node U and each node V, and this way basically create embeddings of the neighborhoods. So that's the reason why. So we will use these embeddings to decide if neighborhood of U is isomorphic to subgraph of neighborhood of V. And we not only predict if there exists a mapping, but we can also, in some cases, be able to identify corresponding nodes, because we'll know that U corresponds to V. So we'll also find the correspondence of anchors. So how are we going to decompose GT into neighborhoods? Basically, for every node in the target graph, we are going to obtain a k-hop neighborhood around the anchor. We can simply do this with using breakfast search. Usually, you know, our parameter k will be around, you know, maybe 3, maybe 4. So basically we go 3 hops out, we go 4 hops out. And this way we can decompose g sub t, the target graph, into a lot of different neighborhoods. And now, as we have created the neighborhood, we simply apply a graph neural network embedding of the anchor node V to map that anchor node into the embedding space. And then we can also do the same procedure to the query to obtain neighborhoods in the query graph. And then we are going to embed these neighborhoods, as I said, using a GNN by computing simply the node embedding for every anchor in its corresponding neighborhood. Now, what is the cool part, and actually the most important part of this lecture, is this notion of a order embedding space. So, you know, what we talked so far was kind of clear and you have perhaps heard about it, but you haven't heard about this topic. This is now super cool. So, order embedding space. Let me explain what we mean by this, right? So we map graph, let's say A, to a point Z sub A in a high dimensional space, let's say 64 dimensional embedding. And we are going to assume that the embedding space is non-negative. So all coordinates are either zero or positive. And then what we would like to do is we'd like to capture partial ordering, transitivity in the embedding space, right? And we are going to use this notation to say that, you know, the left node is less than equal than the right node if all coordinates of the blue node of the left node are less or equal to the all the coordinates of the right node. So, for example, you know, in this case, what this means is we have this transitive relation, because intuitively, when I say all the coordinates to be less, it really means a given point has to be to the lower left of some other point, right? So if this point is lower left of that point, and that same point is lower left of another point, then also the first point is to the lower left of the third point, right? So here, you know, this particular point is to the lower left of that particular point, right? So basically what we want is we wanna have these relationships of being to the lower left, which means in any part of this space, right? Basically all the coordinates have to be less or equal, which means you have to be embedded to the lower left of something else. So, and this is called order embedding because this partial ordering, this transitivity is captured by this relation, are you embedded lower left of something else? So, you know, why should you care, right? Like, why is lower left so cool and so important? The point is that lower left is so important is because it captures subgraph relations. Right. Imagine, for example, the case here is that I have the target graph, I have the neighborhood, and I have different queries. Right. And in my case, imagine that this is the node anchored neighborhood that I embedded here, and I have two anchored queries, query one and query two. And now, because basically the point is the following, because query one is a subgraph of the neighborhood, query one should be embedded to the lower left of the neighborhood, while query 2 is not a subgraph, so it should not be embedded to the lower left, right? So here, this notion of a subgraph relationship is preserved because the query 1 is embedded to the lower left of query 2. And simply by comparing the positions of the embeddings of these anchor nodes, we can determine that, you know, query 1 is a subgraph of anchor node T, while query 2 is not a subgraph of anchor node T. So that's the cool part. We can very quickly read from the embedding whether one is a subgraph of the other. You know, why does this work? Why do we care about this transitive partial ordering in the embedding space? Is because subgraph isomorphism relationship can nicely be encoded in this order embedding space where the order is defined by this relation, are you lower left of somebody else? And the reason is because the order relation, so the lower left relation is transitive, and subgraph isomorphism is also transitive. It has this property of anti-symmetry, which is also encoded in the order embedding, is that if G1 is a subgraph of G2, and G2 is a subgraph of G1, then G1 and G2 are isomorphic. They are the same. So if one point is to the lower left of one and the other one is of the lower left of the first one, then the points are at the same location, so the two graphs are isomorphic. Transitive would mean if G1 is a subgraph of G2, G2 is of G3, then G1 is a subgraph of G3 as well, which again is encoded by the, you know, the subgraph relation. And the last one is this notion of closure under intersection, that the trivial graph of one node is a subgraph of any node. In our case, it would be the embedding at the coordinate origin at 0, 0, 0 is a subgraph of every other embedding. It is to the lower left of any other embedding. So basically, this order embedding space defined by this relation is one point to the lower left of the other has all these properties that the subgraph relation also has. So The reason now that why we are interested in is, as I said, and here I show more formally, is that, you know, the order embedding space captures transitivity, right? In a sense that if first point is the subgraph of the second and the second is of the third, then first is also a subgraph of the third. We have this notion of anti-symmetry, that if one is to the lower left of the other and the other is to the lower left of the first, then they are equivalent, they basically overlap. And then the last one is this closure under intersection, illustrated here on the right. So basically, order embedding space defined by this lower left relation captures the same type of patterns properties that the subgraph relation has. And that's the important part and the cool part of the order embedding space. So now we are going to actually learn the embeddings of these anchored neighborhoods such that the subgraph relation is preserved, right? So we are going to use a GNN to learn the embeddings of neighborhoods, basically to learn the embedding of the anchor node, to preserve this order embedding structure, to preserve the subgraph structure. So the question is, what kind of loss function should we use so that the learned embedding operator reflects this subgraph relationship? And we are going to design a loss function based on what we call order constraint. An order constraint specifies the ideal order of the embedding lower left property that reflects a subgraph relation. So we specify this, what we call order constraint, to ensure that subgraph properties are preserved in the embedding space, right? So basically what this means, here is it written in mathematics, but basically it says that if a query is a subgraph of the target, then every embedding coordinate of the query should be less than the embedding coordinate of the target, right? So if Q is a subgraph of T, then the embedding of the anchor node in T should be to the greater than equal than the embedding of the query Q. So the relationship is this, right? This is the query, that's the target. So the anchor node from the query should be embedded to the lower left of the anchor node of the target, because this is an anchored subgraph of the target. So that's basically what do we mean by order constraint, is that you have to be to the lower left. Now, GNN embeddings are learned using by minimizing what is called a max margin loss. So basically what we are going to do is to define this notion of a loss, where we are saying, okay, so how much is this constraint violated? So basically here we say this is the maximum of zero and the difference in the coordinates, right? So if coordinate ZT is always larger than the coordinate of Q, then this difference will be negative. So maximum of negative and zero is zero. So the violation will be zero. But if the subgraph relation is not preserved, which means that along a given coordinate, Q is to the right or to the top of Z, this means ZQ is greater than ZT, then this difference will be positive. And then maximum of zero and a positive number will be a positive number. So this E is the margin. It will be basically the amount of violation of the order constraint between a given query and a given target, right? So here there is no violation, while in this case there is violation because Q is a subgraph of T, but Q is not embedded to the lower left of T. So along the first dimension, this difference will be positive, so the entire maximum will be positive as well. So this is now how we write, and what is important here is that now this loss, this penalty E, is differentiable. So we'll be able to backpropagate this penalty into the graph neural network architecture. So the embeddings are learned by minimizing this max margin loss. So we have this E that determines the amount of order constraint violation between a given graph and a target. And we call this penalty, this violation, the margin. So we want to learn the correct order embeddings so that the penalty is zero when GQ is a subgraph of GT, and the penalty is greater than zero when GQ is not a subgraph of GT, right? So we want penalty of zero when one is a subgraph, so it has to be embedded to the lower left, and then the penalty will be zero. And if it's not a subgraph, then we want this penalty to be high because GQ should not be embedded to the lower left of GT, right? So to learn this embedding function, we need to construct training examples, right, of GQ and GT, where you know, half of the time GQ will be a subgraph and the other half of the time it won't be. And then, right, when we are going to do the training of the embedding neural network, we are going to make it such that for positive examples, we want to minimize the penalty, and for negative examples, we want to maximize the penalty. So here is how you can write this all out by another kind of hinge loss type expression, where we again say, if it will be for positive examples, I want this to be zero. So you know, I'll get some alpha, and for negative examples, this will be greater than zero. So this expression will be smaller. So I'll wanna be able to minimize this maximum. So now, how do I generate training examples? Is by simply picking an anchor node and then doing a breadth first, kind of a probabilistic breadth first search around it, and this means that I'll have the I'll generate the query that will be a subgraph of a given neighborhood, and then to generate a negative example, I can, you know, corrupt the query by, you know, and perhaps removing a node, adding an edge, removing an edge, things like that, right? So so that it is no longer a subgraph. So, you know, how many of these training examples do I choose so that I can then train my embedding neural network? The idea is, as I train this, I wanna at every iteration sample new training pairs. The benefit is that at every iteration the model will see different subgraph examples, and it will improve performance and it will avoid overfitting. How deep do I wanna make my breadth first search training example sampling and neighborhood sampling? It's kind of a trade-off between runtime and performance. The deeper I go, the longer the runtime, but usually the better embeddings I get. So usually we would use the depth between 3 and 5, also depending a bit on the data set. So, you know, how do I now apply this when a new query arrives? When a new query arrives, the query has an anchor. I simply embed the anchor. And then the procedure is that basically for every other target anchored neighborhood of the target graph, I compare the embedding of the anchored neighborhood with my anchored query embedding. And if the query is embedded to the lower left of that neighborhood, then I say that query is a subgraph of the neighborhood, and otherwise I would say that it's not a subgraph, right? So basically, I can quickly check this by simply asking, is one embedding to the lower left of the other embedding? So let me summarize this part. So we talked about neural subgraph matching, which is a way to formulate subgraph matching as a machine learning problem, and this way sidestep the Empihard problem of subgraph isomorphism. Basically, given a query and given a target graph, we embed the query, we embed the node anchored neighborhoods of the target graph, and we train our neural network embedding function such that it embeds subgraphs in such a way that they are located to the lower left of each other, right? If Q is a subgraph of T, then Q is embedded to the lower left of T. So this is, and at the training time of this embedding neural network, we force it to obey this subgraph relation. And this means we can then very easily and quickly find out whether query is a subgraph of a given target neighborhood T. So basically, embedding graphs with this order embedding property or order embedding space allows us to test subgraph isomorphism very, very quickly by simply just comparing the coordinates, basically saying, is the query embedded to the lower left of the target? And given the properties of the subgraph isomorphism operator or relation, we see that we can perfectly encode it into the order embedding space, which means that actually all this is possible, and we can do it, and it works well in practice.